always knew that I was interested in social good. And actually, when I first got to college, I thought my dream job was working at the UN. I knew that I wanted to help people, and I'd always had websites on the side. And I never realized that you could combine the two. The first computer that I got was a hand-me-down from my godfather when I was in the third grade. And I used to love writing emails to like my family members about like what I did in the third grade. I really liked Neopets, which is an online game where you can have your own little pet and take care of it. But there was also this whole other world that was included in Neopets. You could have little guilds. That's how I ended up learning HTML and CSS, was building different designs and different layouts for your guild, because that's how you got people to join, was that you had really cool like HTML, CSS. Through Neopets, I ended up having my own tutorial site. I was about 13, and I had a website called html-girl.net, and it was a tutorial site so that I could teach people how to code. I guess this was very like hackers-esque at the time. It had like Angelina Jolie with a pink overlay of code on it. I'm very lucky that I was able to find out at a younger age what I liked and what I didn't like. That's something that everybody doesn't get the opportunity to do, especially through technology. I'd gone to a summer program at MIT where I ended up studying 3D character design and animation, and I realized that I actually didn't like it, but I realized that I really liked web development. This is when I was like 14. I ended up working at that same summer program when I was around 18. I had been taking contract jobs and I had been doing internships, and I started working at America's Test Kitchen. That job was really life-changing. They hired me for basic HTML and CSS on their front end, but it was the first time that I got to work with newer technology, newer software. As I was learning, I realized, oh, I can actually apply for jobs and be willing to learn newer technology and eventually put those things on my resume. It opened my eyes to really seeing my potential value and my potential worth versus just the things that I had learned, feeling that I needed to be perfect and really good at those things. And then eventually I joined Squarespace. As a developer evangelist, 50% of my time is coding, and the other 50% of my time is like education, workshops, events, and community development. I don't enjoy coding all the time, and I don't enjoy teaching or speaking all the time. It's a very good balance, and I really enjoy what I do. One of the really awesome things about technology is that there are new positions being created, or new titles, new job titles popping up all the time that people have never heard of. Your passion and your creativity and you are constantly growing and changing. And I was able to finally realize that I didn't just want to do one thing or the other, and that I had a lot of passion for different things. CoderDojo is actually a global movement of free coding clubs for youth. And so if you look up the hashtag CoderDojo on any Saturday or Sunday, there are events all across the globe going on. It's not a standard classroom setting, where a standard classroom setting has one teacher and 30 students. We have a 1-to-5 ratio, or we'll have one mentor per 5 students that can help guide those students through whatever project that they're working on. They're able to have that early access to education, to exposure, and also to role models, to people that are already in the tech industry and working as professionals, and to see both men and women who have made careers for themselves in technology. I don't think it's the idea that everybody should become a programmer. I think it's that everybody should have access to that education or have access to it as a skill, that it's something useful that you can use later on no matter what career that you take. And just like we learn to read and write in schools, you could learn at least the basics or how computers really work to change the idea of us just being consumers of technology and being able to be a creator through technology.
I tweet a lot about women in technology. I tweet a lot about social good and nonprofits.
There's definitely a lot of assumptions that go on, a lot of bias that people have based on other people's appearances, whether it's that they're dressed down or they're dressed up. People have said things like, oh, well, you're too pretty to be a programmer, or oh, you don't look like a programmer. And it's like, really? There's programmers from all different backgrounds. What's a programmer supposed to look like? Somebody had pointed out to me that the idea of diversity in tech isn't just saying, well, we need this many people, this many ethnicity, or this many people from this background. It's actually just having a welcoming, inclusive environment that feels like it's just safe and acceptable to be you, whatever your background is.
Everything science, so I study a lot of biochemistry. I taught it. All right, so now
women in tech groups, it's just really useful to have like other women who are developers or engineers at other companies, so that when you have a problem at work, you can talk to them about it, about similar programming problems or workplace problems. The best place to find them actually is through meetup.com. Type in like women in tech or like whatever programming language you're interested in. If there isn't a meetup in your area, like starting one, even just if it becomes like a study group of like, hey, we're all learning to code, so let's get together. I've definitely seen people who are afraid to enter new careers or enter into technology because they feel like, oh, well, you know, I've never done that before, so how am I going to get into it now? You have the capacity to grow and to learn. Maybe you won't be the best programmer. I'm not the best programmer or coder in the world. But I know that I still have a lot to learn and that I can learn a lot more.